Hello, everyone. I'm Jay Woldar, a director with ISG in the Banking and Financial Services Group. Welcome to Tech Exchange and our virtual conference for 2020. What I'll be speaking to you about today is the evolving automation across the financial services landscape. I usually like to start with like very basic stuff so that everybody understands where automation can fit into our lives and help us in being able to improve the way in which we both do our business and provide our services out to the community. So I like to define automation as the method or technique of controlling a process through the use of mechanical or electronic device to reduce the need for human intervention. So in thinking back historically, we talk about manual labor and the invention of the pulley back to the Egyptian time in 1800 BCE. And think about how they were able to move the rocks to be able to build the pyramids. People understood that we needed to be able to, instead of just having a bunch of people lifting up rocks, we needed to figure out a better way of doing things. This was one of the early stages of automation, along with the creation of the wheel. Then we carry forward to when we decided that we needed to be able to utilize alternative power, not just manpower, to be able to accomplish tasks. And that's where we insert the windmill. So this goes back to the 900s and was actually in different areas of Asia that windmills were developed almost simultaneously. But they were developed for the purposes of being able to irrigate fields and use water to be able to move things around. Once again, using an alternative energy source to be able to help and facilitate specific tasks in our lives. Carry forward to 1698 with the invention of the steam engine. So this is once again, man developing skills and skill sets to be able to utilize some automation to be able to make their lives easier and better. And the steam engine was a classic example where you, just the basic of actually boiling water to be able to drive steam, to turn a turbine, enabled us to be able to utilize that type of power to be able to help us with our different tasks. And that actually was really the fundamental start to being able to bring on the Industrial Revolution. So from 1760 to 1840 is when the Industrial Revolution really occurred. And this was where it was a significant transformation in the way in which labor was transferred and then automation and machinery was utilized to be able to help us in our day-to-day lives. In this case, automation was used to be able to develop machinery to be able to help with manufacturing and production and be able to reduce the cost of labor, to be able to produce more goods, and to be able to utilize machines to do tasks that humans do and do them more effectively. Carry that forward now into the computer age. So the 1940s was really when we saw the computer age take off. This was following World War II, when they actually developed computers as a way of being able to break codes to be able to try and help with the war efforts. Computers were developed as a way of being able to analyze data and be able to do it more quickly than humans could do it themselves. That particular advancement led us to, you know, the development of all type of computer applications. Carry that into where this really applies to the financial services industry and banking is where we are with the automated teller machine and the introduction in 1967. I don't think any of us today would be able to understand how banking was accomplished without the automated teller machine being utilized in our system. Talk about being able to access cash, make deposits, do banking related items off hours, going back to the 60s. One of the things that's really important about utilizing the ATM in this particular example is this is something that was able to impact everyday life through the use of a particular automation adopted for banking, and that's something that was adopted easily by the consumer. One of the things that's really continued this advancement is really computers and banking services with online banking, with the adoption of mobile applications, enabling us to be able to utilize the banking system more easily than we would have normally, and frankly, in any location that we want to, so that it's just being able to make the customer experience better, transforming the way we're working, transforming the way we're living, and be able to help us in our day-to-day lives. So one of the key points that I'd like to take out of this particular just step of this evolution is that the pace of change is accelerating. Talk about things that go back to the 1800s BCE, to the advancement of the computer age into the automated teller machine, and then the development of mobile applications. The speed of change is coming quickly. We need to be able to adapt if we're going to be able to work with it. And we also need to be able to learn to be able to accept the pace of change as we're able to be able to move forward with accepting automation as a way of doing things better. So the topic that we're talking about is automation and how it's going to help us. It's also about talking about how automation can transform the way we work. Now, this slide tries to illustrate some specific elements and tools that we utilize to be able to adopt automation into our everyday work life. And specifically, we'll be able to identify certain use cases and how they apply to the banking and financial services industry. So moving from the left to the right, robotic process automation, intelligent character recognition, natural language processing, cognitive reasoning, and conversational artificial intelligence. Talking about this and understanding how to transform the way we work, robotic process automation is a sequential series of commands that are being able to be established to be able to achieve a specific task. Now, in doing so, understanding how robotic process automation really it's about understanding, can we take specific steps, set up a computer with a series of commands to be able to achieve those steps, be able to do that in such a way to be able to create a very high level of accuracy and enable people to be able to check this work so we can see it each step of the way. There are certain examples, and I want to be able to highlight use cases and examples as I go through this, but I want to talk about, you know, where examples of RPA really apply within the banking structure. So talk about branch closeout and branch closeout procedures. So each individual teller has to close out their individual teller station. Then that rolls up to how the branch closes out. And then they close the branch out by being able to do a series of accounting procedures to be able to ensure that all the money is accounted for properly and all the debits and credits are accounted for in the way so that they can prove out each station, prove out the branch. And then they roll that up into the actual, like say, regional branch network. These type of tasks have always been traditionally very manual in nature, but by being able to apply RPA to these tasks, we're not only able to accelerate the closeout process, we're able to ensure and identify any errors quickly and be able to ensure that these things are done in a timely as well as effective manner. Another classic example of RPA would be your proof and control in the back office. So not necessarily in a branch, but think about in a check processing environment or in a payment and closeout area where we need to be able to do proof so that we understand where those debits and credits are hitting, be able to understand what the control is to ensure those transactions are processed accurately, and then to be able to ensure that everything is rolling up to the right account process correctly. Another RPA application would be probably a good example would be password resets. This is a case where an individual would be calling into a help desk or going onto a system to be able to reset their password. If they can answer a series of questions, they'd be able to be given a link to be able to reset their password themselves. This is a way of being able to alleviate some of the manual intervention and human intervention that's required today in the banking system. So let's talk about ICR. Intelligent character recognition is something that's been used for a long time. I have a few specific personal examples, but intelligent character recognition is really most applicable in like wholesale and retail lockbox, and where you're talking about looking at a specific invoice, and the term that we used to use was rope and zone. So basically you'd be looking at a specific area of the invoice to be able to extract data. In the old wholesale lockbox days, we used to pay people to actually key that data. They developed ICR as a way of being able to extract the data from those invoices, compile that into reports, balance and match that against the payments, the incoming payments that are being mailed to that individual organization, and then be able to prep that for deposit. In this way, the institution has the ability to extract the data with minimal individual human intervention and still assure that the processed payments are being done correctly and the information is flowing through accurately. I specifically have a great example of when ICR was adopted. Talk about how check processing used to be done back in the late 80s into the 90s, we used to use MICR, which is magnetic ink character recognition. And it's the numbers at the bottom of your check for those people who still write checks. So for the, what the machines used to do, there used to be a machine called the IBM 3890. And this used to actually electrify the information on the bottom of those checks. That's why it's magnetic ink. And then the system would be able to read those numbers and be able to process those checks. Unfortunately, the checks would have to run through the sorter multiple times. And then if somebody needed to get their statements with their checks back, each individual check would have to be run through the system multiple times. I happen to have worked on a project in 1989 where Chase Manhattan Bank converted from the old 3890 high-speed capture machinery to image capture under the Unisys system. And what they did was they put cameras into the machines and they actually took pictures of the checks and digitized those images. In that way, they were able to actually use the ICR to capture the information and then be able to pass that information on to the account holders to be able to debit and credit correctly. But at the same time, they only needed to pass that check through the sorter once. And it saved an awful lot of money, created a high level of accuracy, and it was a great way in which we were able to advance the digitization of the process of check processing. Let me turn to the next item on the list, which is natural language processing. So natural language processing really about utilizing computer techniques, computational techniques, and analysis to be able to use real life speech language to be able to understand and analyze data through use of computers. So NLP basically is about understanding how a voice response system can work, you know, do certain things as far as reporting, but it's about the computer being able to understand language and then be able to communicate, analyze the data, and communicate back. Some examples of this would be our voice response systems, systems that actually complete background screening to be able to look for keywords, and also candidate review would be another example. So the systems would actually be analyzing resumes and CVs to be able to look for certain key terms that would be required for that particular position. By doing so, it enables the recruiters to minimize the number of applicants they need to see and be able to hone in on those specific candidates that are most likely to be good to be able to be looked at for hire. If you know how systems work with regard to recruiting now, you know, you put out a really high level position and you can get hundreds, if not more, resumes for that particular application. It'd be a pretty daunting task to ask any individual to be honing through those. So the computer programs really enable those particular recruiters in the systems to be able to work much more effectively and much more rapidly in being able to get down to the correct candidates. So the next item on the list is cognitive reasoning. So cognitive reasoning is really about the idea of making complex decisions based on those previous, you know, based on previous knowledge. So basically learning based on what's going on and what's happened before. So these algorithms that were developed for the purposes of saying, okay, if there's some predictive information that can occur based on information that's provided in the forms, in the system, through their transactional activities, they can then actually be able to become predictive as to whether or not somebody is, in this example, a good risk to be able to extend credit. So risk management is a great example. Credit scoring is another example where you have the ability with which to be able to look at certain information and be predictive about what's going on for the next particular set. Another way would be KYC validation. So a lot of the things that happen in the account opening process is know your customer, and there's certain information needs to be extracted so that the system can actually validate whether or not those particular individuals opening the accounts have met the standards under which they're able to actually have a valid account open to that financial institution. So this is one of the ways cognitive reasoning really aids in the back office in being able to also understand how it aids in the front office and how individuals interact with consumers to be able to do business with the banks more easily. Another specific example of cognitive reasoning is anti-money laundering. So anti-money laundering has the ability with which to be able to identify when they believe fraud or money laundering might be occurring within the banking system. So the cognitive reasoning basically looks for patterns in activity, deposits of a certain number of amount, deposits being made in different locations, money moving where it necessarily shouldn't and or in large blocks of money. It's really just about flagging things. It's also about trying to minimize the number of false positives that occur so that they're not trying to indicate what's going on as far as the system is concerned. So the last item on this slide is about conversational artificial intelligence. And artificial intelligence is about being able to utilize some of these other specific capabilities to be able to work them through the system. So evolving natural language processing to enable automatic chatbots and individual systems, customer service systems and chatbot systems to interact and converse with users. This is one of the ways in which the natural language processing as well as the cognitive reasoning are coupled together to be able to create this conversational artificial intelligence. And a couple examples of that would be the IT help desk, in which case somebody might be able to express what their issue is to a system that is then able to identify ways they can resolve their problem. Another specific issue, which is probably very commonplace, and actually a couple of the other presentations today are going to be focusing on it, but it's about customer service. So being able to utilize chatbots and artificial intelligence to be able to address customer service, to be able to reduce the call times, reduce the wait times until you actually speak to and or connect with one of these systems, and to be able to resolve that issue as quickly as possible. The keys here are really about utilizing automation to be able to increase productivity, improve the customer experience, reducing errors, and reducing costs. Adopting automation is about driving productivity, reducing costs, and once again, very key, it's about improving the customer experience. So the final topic I'm going to talk about in today's presentation is intelligent automation and how intelligent automation opens up opportunities and functions not touched by RPA. And it's really in that second title, it's really about expanding the pipeline for automation adoption in the different areas of the financial institution, the back office, the middle office, and the front office. I will work this slide from left to right. But so look at intelligent automation in unlocking new applications. So throughout the banking and financial services sector, understanding the tools that are available to us and how they apply enable us to be able to adopt them to different functions in those particular areas, back office, middle office, and front office. So when you think about the traditional back office, it's that operational area that's working behind the scenes to be able to do the normal processing, to do the accounting, the closeouts, you know, processing payments, processing, you know, check transactions, working through the credit card systems, all the things like that that are actually operating in the back office. So RPA and ICR, it's image recognition, and OCR, which is optical character recognition, it's all about understanding how a machine can be able to extract information from a printed page as long as it understands what it's looking for and where it should be extracting that data. So data extraction and a summary. So a couple of examples of where this happens is in the bank operations area, automating transactional activities, improving productivity and accuracy, and being able to speed work to completion. So about creating this pipeline for the back office, talk about payment and collection activity. That would be a classic example where you want to be able to make sure that you're utilizing RPA and the image OCR activity to be able to speed the work, make sure the accuracy of the work is done more correctly, alleviate that from the individual's human task, and then be able to allow somebody to be able to still be able to proof that material to ensure accuracy. As these particular automations are set up, and obviously as they work for a longer period of time, the comfort level as far as the accuracy is concerned is assured. But this is one of the ways. So a good example of where RPA and OCR and ICR are once again in that wholesale lockbox. So which is traditionally a very manually intensive, slow process and a rather costly and expensive process for those individual corporations that utilized wholesale lockbox. You'd actually have to physically look at a transaction, extract the data, pull the information out, create a report, then be able to balance that against the transaction to be able to post those transactions. When I was working with a legacy Wells Fargo bank, we used to use the the OCR and the image recognition to be able to alleviate that and drive a lot of efficiency through our lockbox network. It was something that was adopted very quickly, and it was something that was utilized very well. So let's talk about the middle office. So middle office is really where you're taking some of the transactional activity, but then you're probably working that information for the sake of being able to provide the front office with decision-making on how to go forward with engaging with either business or consumer clients, analyzing data and making decisions. So this is where the whole idea of pattern recognition, cognitive reasoning, and machine learning. So driving speed of responsiveness and accuracy of reporting to be able to get better outcomes, be faster, be there at the right time, and then also be able to, in a number of cases, be able to identify fraud or identify transactions that sit outside of the norm to be able to minimize any type of loss on behalf of your clients. So examples of this would be, once again, the KYC reporting for account opening, AML reporting, which triggers fraud detection. Another one would be probably credit underwriting for credit cards and limit assignment. And where that really applies is if an individual has been a customer of the bank for a period of time, their activity is use of their card, but they're actually pushing up against that limit, they probably have the buying power with which to be able to extend past that. And they have a pretty strong pattern of financial performance of paying their bills and reducing down their debt. It's probably at that point where you'd want to be able to make sure that you go to them and extend that credit, because you don't want them necessarily going to look to an alternative financial institution. You'd like to be able to maintain as much of their business and share of wallet as possible. I always thought of that as being a pretty good example for that. So looking at the front office and where natural language processing, attended automation, visual assistance, and ChatSpot, this is really about trying to improve the customer experience. And here's a good example. Younger generations would rather deal with an app than with a person. It's just something that they're more familiar with, they're more comfortable with. Getting information from an app, getting information from the online banking system, being able to understand that. So adapting to those demographics and the way in which people want to do business is the way in which we're able to adapt to the very rapidly changing pace of the marketplace we're operating in. A use case for this would be share of wallet analytics to present investment options to an individual, a couple, or an individual who might be looking for a mortgage because they're evolving in their lifestyle to the point that they want to buy a house, or to the point where they're looking for, what are the next set of financial transactions, whether it's investments, whether they're going out and doing specific investment activity, or once again, looking to buy a home. It's very important to be able to, one, understand the timing of when that should occur, two, understand the channel that you should be communicating with in that particular individual so that you're getting to that person in the right way at the right time. And then probably have a much more better likelihood of connecting with them for the purposes of being able to drive that transaction and, frankly, keeping their business and or expanding your business with that individual consumer, or frankly, with another business. If it's a business client, it might be that they're expanding, opening up a new restaurant, opening up a new store, something to that degree, making sure that you're ready for that and prepared to be able to extend to them the type of financial instruments that they need to be more effective in doing their jobs. So let's talk about what's really important here, and really what I've tried to identify here in the course of this presentation is if we're going to adapt automation to the banking system in a banking workplace, it's really about, one, understanding what that automation and what those tools look like, two, being able to kind of work through the minefield of the number of providers and the number of tools that are available to be able to utilize the appropriate set of tools that works for you. Adapting, it's really about adapting or falling behind. The pace of change today is extremely fast. And if you get too far behind, it almost seems like there's a problem with even trying to catch up. So you have to build and foster a strong center of excellence to be able to do that. I think that that's one of the keys that we've seen in the banks and the financial institutions that have adopted automation and being able to work it through their organization. It's really about developing a strong center of excellence and being able to understand what the strategy is, understand how that strategy is going to be deployed in the back office, middle office, and front office of that organization, and then being able to utilize some factors of organizational change management so that the staff in each of these areas understands that automation is there to be able to improve the way we're doing business. It's not about just identifying areas where we can eliminate staff. It's about understanding how we can improve the way we're engaging with our customers to be able to drive productivity higher across the business, to be able to lower your costs, lower your specific error rates, and then be able to improve the customer experience. The other thing that I really want to make sure is clear is that the pace of change is accelerating almost at an exponential level. And it's almost to the point where it's either you get on board and understand what's going on, or you're going to be left behind. One of the things that we're really trying to do here is to be able to educate everyone as to the different capabilities that are aware and available to them to be able to most effectively use them for your particular financial institution. And I hope we've had the ability to convey that today. Thank you very much. As we get to the end of the presentation, we'll actually be moving into one of my panel discussions. So as I get ready for that panel, hopefully you guys will want to be able to enjoy that as well as we talk about how the evolving automation landscape is impacting financial institutions and how those particular tools and capabilities are looked at in different institutions of different sizes. So I look forward to being able to share that panel with you shortly. Thank you.